fucking holidays.
Fuck Jesus, no, shit. Oh, fuck God. We live. Fuck, we live.
God damn it. Christmas.
Oh, we're live. Guys, we're live. Fuck.
I thought that was our reference for the same time.
Shit.
Everything's always fucking
this is
on
this
holidays.
Is the worst.
Everything is fucked always, forever.
I mean, at least I have water.
I've got water, too. Does anyone not have water? Who
I
wants
don't.
Water?
You know that I forgot to get water.
Christmas.
Being intentionally cruel.
Christmas, right, everybody? I mean...
Yeah, you know, just really want to make sure I'm on that naughty list.
Yeah, me too.
Absolutely.
Because, you know,
hi, everybody.
Fossil fuels are getting more expensive.
Did you say...
We need them. We need that
fossil
we need
fuels
that damn
or
coal.
Pasta fuels?
Fossil.
I heard pasta fuels are getting
pasta
more expensive.
Fuels probably are getting more expensive too.
What are these pasta fuels?
Just thanks for reminding us, Gary. Thanks for reminding us about that.
I
this
just
is
filled up with pasta fuels
what
today.
Theater live for the goddamn holidays.
What did Gary remind? Oh, Gary, I thought
the expense of pasta fuels.
Yeah,
saying something sassy.
I'm sorry. I couldn't be just super jolly right at the beginning. But you know, letting it out like this. It feels better.
Mm.
I think it's good.
Yeah.
Put it out there. Yeah. Yeah.
A little pre-holiday purge.
Yeah, for sure.
I like the lukewarm laugh, the new lukewarm laughter.
Yeah, that was
really appropriate for this show.
It really was. It really was. So we have a fun show for you today. We have a little preview of Kringle Down 2 coming to you. And if you haven't listened to the first Kringle Down last Christmas, our last Christmas special, what are you doing? It's $3. It's like maybe just a little bit shorter than Die Hard and possibly as much action.
If not more.
Definitely no Yetis in Die Hard. So we've got that on it.
So
sure.
What's the point?
Kringle Down, Shane Lacey Hensley. Go pick it up on our platform. And next week on the 23rd, a Thursday from now, which is Thursday, you can get Kringle Down too.
I don't know why I found that so funny.
Just a reminder for anybody who forgot what day it is. Today
from now, which
is Thursday. And next week will be Thursday.
And Shane Lacey Hensley is currently waiting in the wings to come and be our...
His own wings.
Interviewee. His own wings. His own wings. We don't, our wings were not sufficient for him. So he went off and winged himself. And so, yeah, he'll be here in just a few minutes to talk about his new holiday special. And also whatever else is happening at Pinnacle Entertainment. Those guys are always incredibly busy putting out, tabletop RPGs for y'all. What else we got today? We got, some Dark Knight, script reading to do.
Yes.
Morgan Freeman versus
the other guy,
some scared little white guy, and yeah, that's gonna be fun. I don't know how many different ways we can do that scene, but we'll figure it out.
Maybe we
can get some suggestions from the audience right now. There's eight people here at least watching us, so please do join us in the chat. Please say hi in the chat. By the way, Ron Big is here in the chat. Nyx is here. Stakey, Sonovar,
DeProf is
we
here.
We got
and here.
Caden. Michelle Hensley.
Ooh. Yeah.
Michelle Hensley, is that Shane's wife, maybe? I'm not sure. Maybe his sister? And yeah, looks like that's it. But please say hello in the chat, and we will say hi back. And let's see. We have some Gary's... Do we have a plan for Gary's games today?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
we're
going to
play
yes.
the commercials game again.
Oh,
we roll the D20 thrice, and I'm writing in new things as we go because it's still the same version, but I want to change it up, so I will do so.
Okay, so Ron Biggs already given us a suggestion for one of the characters in the Dark Knight scene, Carl's Dungeon AI doing a new achievement announcement. Okay, okay, I'll try and see which one of those characters that's going to work for. We may need to like ad lib as well, not just read pure from the script, you know,
yeah,
like depending on who
it.
We're playing as. Yes. So, yes. Michelle Hensley is Shane's wife. So thank you for joining us.
Hello.
Michelle. All right. So other than that, do we, what else can we do?
We're doing a read from
Forging Zero. So for those of you who don't know, I've been working on an audiobook called Forging Zero. It is a novel that was released all the way back in 2013 at the beginning of the huge Kindle boom. And back then, there was an author named Sarah King who was absolutely killing it in the sci-fi world. And this was her first book. Still remains, I think, her bestseller. I'm working on it very slowly because it's a big one. It's a big book. And this week, I've been absolutely swamped with other production for all of our other stuff that's going to be on our platform. But rest assured, this book is going to be amazing when it's done in audio. And this particular scene that we picked out, because we were like, what the fuck are we going to do? is a very inappropriate scene that we will all read and laugh at. Yay. So, yeah. Great stuff. Awesome show.
Things for the Christmas show.
We have to be inappropriate. What else is there to do but be inappropriate during the holidays? And Kringle Down just really kicks it off for us. Again, if you haven't listened to it, it's like if, you know, Quentin Tarantino got a hold of Christmas and ruined it for everybody.
I mean, that just sounds pretty great to me.
Yeah, it is pretty great. And the sequel, I think, almost as good. Almost as good. Harlan Guthrie knocked it out of the park with the sound effects. So we're going to hear it. When we do a little sample today, we're going to hear the 3D sound that he incorporated. Indeed, it's going to be good. So how's everybody doing?
Great.
Pretty good. Feeling festive with this hat. Mm-hmm. I'm going to Ireland next week.
Ooh.
Oh, lucky.
Yeah, to visit my family.
Okay. I've never been.
You're lucky. You don't want to go there.
I'm great, too. I scored this Christmas ornament drinking cup from Quality Thrift for 99 cents.
That sounds like a fantastic find.
Is it definitely a drinking cup or just something you repurposed?
Oh, that's a good question.
Why not both?
Yeah, I mean,
could be a...
It's a drinking cup that I've repurposed, but I'm using it as a drinking cup tonight.
You repurposed which liquid?
My own blood. It's mine.
By the way, guys, if any of you are Stars Have Eyes fans, we are trying to fix it right now.
Literally right now.
I am waiting for the new export of those Chapter 3 files. I'll be uploading them to the system during the show, and you will all know in real time when it's ready to delete and re-download on your apps. So please stand by for that. We'll also be sending out an email. An email already went out saying that it was fixed.
No.
I know.
My bad, y'all. It was my fault.
Yeah, I tried to be proactive about it, and I told the person who was handling the emails, all right, stand by. We want this email to go out when I tell you to.
And they're like, right now?
Boop. Yeah, and then they were like, beep.
Guys, I'm going to...
And they sent it out. So now everybody's who got that email is probably like, what? It's still...
But it's not fixed yet.
I mean, shit happens. There's a famous story among us narrator folk that a dude we know had sent his book to ACX, got up on Audible, and he forgot to edit out a fucking epic rant he did in the middle of the book by accident, just saying how shit he thought the book was. And the only way they found out was because in the reviews, someone was like, I don't know if y'all heard this, but like in chapter 6, the narrator goes ape shit. And they saw it, and he had to like go to the author and be like, we have to take this down, and tell him why they had to take it down.
He is
doing fantastically well. So, you know, shit happens.
Really?
Oh, yeah, he's great. He's one of the best out there.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
It was just
wow.
like, it was such a funny story. I remember he told him, just like, oh, no.
I thankfully have not done one of those rants since, you know, very early years of my career anyway. I feel very thankful for that.
Like, yep, exactly. Stopped. Fuck you, book.
And I definitely wasn't streaming at the time.
It was not Jeff. It was a guy called Hef Jays, okay?
Hef Jays, exactly.
It was Hef very Jays. Different.
Almost it's, like Hefe.
And it's Portuguese, so you don't have to change the spelling at all. That's Portuguese. Here. That's what is that? What would that? No, that'd be Spanish. So, sorry.
You guys have to ask. Ron Big. Am I saying your name right, Ron Big?
Yeah.
Does the hat distribute eggnog when you pull on its tips? If not, you bought a lesser hat. Okay, my question to you is, does yours? Are you trying to tell me you have a hat that distributes
eggnog?
What kind of
mammary hat do you have?
Mammary hat.
I mean, because if you do have that hat...
Does such a hat exist, like, from the bauble?
Put a link in the comments.
Mm-hmm.
Leave an affiliate link in the comments.
Leave an affiliate link.
We'll make sure to go buy it.
By the way, another thing that we could do for content, and Annie, if you want to take this and listen to it privately for a second to see if you're interested in doing it for tonight, we've been getting a lot of requests from people wanting to hear this song sung by you. I just put it in the chat here.
What
in
is it?
In StreamYard, mm-hmm. And it would definitely be in the Christmas spirit. Yeah, no, so let's not listen to her. Listen to it. It may be.
Wait. Sorry. I'm such a. Sorry.
It's okay. You can go listen private if you want to.
I'm gonna probably take you out of the show. Shit on.
Now she's muted. Okay. Now she's just cussing us out.
You don't have a lot.
She's just like, I'm going to chop your penis into this mini section.
Like, I'm going to hold one in my hand. I'm going to throw it out the window. I'll stick someone in my hat. It is not right for us to have this power. So at some point, maybe we get muted one by one. And
yeah.
Like, just say some game. Random shit and you can.
Just like that.
Yeah.
Just okay. Wearing like just via visuals.
So really we can continue to bullshit until Mr. Shane Hensley gets here and hang out with the chat here.
Okay,
Sonavar says,
I'm definitely not gonna be able to learn this song by listening to it once, but I can play the YouTube video and sing along with it.
That works.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds like fun.
Yeah,
okay.
I mean, I think that'll be fun. It'll be entertaining. It's like...
Someone disagrees.
Excuse me?
Wow.
Oh, it's going to happen now.
Okay.
Oh, it's happening.
Yeah, I think...
I don't get X'd. I don't get the...
This isn't America's Got Talent, you fuck.
Ahmed, if you
Family Feud.
If you take that link and maybe you can stream it from your end and we can... have any sing it.
Facebook user has said Die Hard is a Christmas movie.
No, they couldn't hear it.
Disagree with that.
Well, I need to read it too, though.
How is it not a Christmas
movie? No, we can.
Okay.
I think it is.
Play it
okay.
Here.
Okay.
So you can play it, you can stream it, and we can see the lyrics. And we're doing it right now?
No, not right now.
Probably be some.
Well, maybe right now. Shane's not back yet.
I mean, I can't hear it very well now.
Christmas Day. What is this?
This is so cute.
Oh, it's just the music. Do you remember this song? Sleepy Dave, hello.
Oh, fuck. Welcome, Christmas. Oh, see, you can hear the other person. I don't hear it loud enough on my ear. Maybe we can dial this in and try it again later on.
Yeah.
In the meantime. Has anybody tried the gingerbread flavored?
Oh, God.
Welcome Christmas,
Okay. It's definitely out of sync. That's the problem. You're just reading and singing it like just a half second after. So
that's why it's entertaining.
We tried.
Okay, we did it.
We did it. Thank you.
Has anybody tried
the gingerbread flavored Mountain Dew?
What? That sounds like the biggest bar fest I've ever heard
Artificially flavored gingerbread Mountain Dew. And actually, if we can get a visual of this shit,
it is hilarious.
I'm telling you that the gingerbread men on the Mountain Dew look exactly like they're supposed to look like because they look like fucking juggalos. They look like gingerbread juggalos.
Oh my God.
Which is exactly who gingerbread Mountain Dew should be 100%. Catering to.
100%.
No offense to any juggalos in the house. I myself have my own favorites.
Your favorite of the hatchet family?
Of the ICP songs, yeah.
Okay, all right.
But you gotta see these juggalo gingerbread men hanging out on the Mountain Dew.
They are juggalos.
Oh my God.
You're right. You're fucking right.
Ginger snapped.
I love how it's clear because every color that they tried that they were thinking would look like a good gingerbread flavor color, it probably all looked like diarrhea.
Ended up looking like diarrhea, exactly. Yeah.
They should just alternate like red and dark green.
Why don't
like
they just make
colors.
It green though?
Exactly.
Like I want something green to put in my ornament cup, and what better than the gingerbread snapped Mountain Dew.
Have they colored it to look like those gingerbread men are like bleeding from the mouth?
They are bleeding from the mouth because they drank too much of
it. It looks like
that.
They're fucked up.
Oh yeah.
Like, I know I can't see it like super clear, but it looks like the guy on the top throwing the ball is like he's got blood coming out of his mouth. He's got blood over his one eye. Mm-hmm. The other guy has blood coming out of his crotchal area. It looks like.
Yep.
It's just a very violent fucking
his crotchal area. Is that the scientific term?
I think it is.
In Ireland.
I think it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're just like, look, give us like your crotchal there. I have had an awful case.
Look at this guy.
Look at this
little green mohawked guy.
Oh man, what?
He's shoving up that guy's butt.
That's amazing.
This is horrific.
Isn't this wonderful? I gotta get some.
Of this gingerbread. Snap!
Oh my God.
I did not realize it was clear though. That's very disappointing. I saw a can.
That's horrific.
I wanted diarrhea colors. Why would you make it clear?
That's, yeah, give us the diarrhea.
I bet if you drink enough.
Diarrhea.
Well, guys, Shane should be here any minute. So what do you got? Oh, there he is. There he is.
Oh, speak of the devil.
Speak of the devil. Shane Lacey Hensley, how are you, sir?
Oh, man, I love the fake claps.
Say again?
I love the fake claps. It makes me feel
They're real. We have an orchestra.
A studio audience.
It's not the audience. It's the orchestra in the pit. Yeah,
they're not playing their instruments. We can't afford that. But they do clap.
That's awesome.
How has your time coming towards the holiday, Ben? Your December.
Oh, man. This month just flies by, doesn't it? Thanksgiving like a minute ago?
It was.
Like, it does feel literally, and this has come from an Irish person. I'm like, live in Texas now, but it was just like, oh, Thanksgiving last week. It's like, no, fucking wasn't.
Yeah. Man, I just can't help but see Red Jack every time you speak.
Me?
Yeah.
He's the author. Yeah, I know. I mean, yeah, I remember. Cool. I remember. Yeah.
To you guys, I guess you're 1,000 different characters, right?
But
to
right. Me,
yeah.
Man, well, now do you say it? I'm like, that guy was
Gary's
great
been like 88
to be,
men
like, to narrate
since he's been that guy.
Yeah. How many men have been in you?
Too many.
Come from you.
Too many. Actually, not enough. Gary,
you know what's really funny? Gary has. How much gay romance have you done? I mean,
all
like audiobooks, not
all of
like
it.
It's like if I was to be typecast, I am a male romance narrator. That's my genre. I have narrated about penises, let me tell you.
Shane, you were so much more accurate than you even thought.
Some guys have all the luck.
I've had men in me. I've been in men.
I usually am. You know, oddly enough, right after I released Kringle Down 2 on Amazon, there was a cartel attack in Cancun, which is where the story takes place.
Oh, whoa.
Yeah, so you do not want me writing anything else.
Wow.
Bad.
Yes, damn. Do not write that Gary prophetic. Being in or in someone else in Gary for his sake.
Yeah, no one else
like,
in Gary.
That window back there will start to open, and I'm like, oh, shit!
So, yes, speaking of Kringle Down 2, Shane, can you tell us you've even got the paperback right there.
Nice. Cool? Look at these covers. I love the covers. Artist's work.
They're so good.
They're real good.
So first of all, guys, if you missed this earlier in the show, Kringle Down was our very first Christmas special on the SBT platform. It's still only $3. So go pick it up if you're interested in having a really fun, everyone gets blown away Christmas.
And as usual, you guys knocked it out of the park.
Oh, man. Kringle Down, it's one of my favorite things that I've ever done. And a lot of that has to do with Harlan Guthrie, for sure, coming in. Like, that was his first project with us. And it's incredible how good of a job he did. It really does. It is, I hope someday that people recognize it as a true Christmas classic that they will listen to as well. It does remind me of Die Hard and like other, and I think Shane, you might have even said Tarantino, like you even probably cited him as an inspiration for it.
Absolutely.
So can you tell us more about how you came up with Kringle Down in the first place? And then how you came up with Kringle Down 2? Because when I read that story, I never thought in a million years that we'd get a sequel out of it.
And I have a third too.
Oh,
for next year. Yeah. So first off, before I forget, when I said you guys knocked it out of the park, I was going to add, you know, there are little touches in the Soundbooth theater performance that I don't know how many people really pay attention to or can hear. You know, sometimes you're listening to it in a car or something, and there's little effects you guys work in that are just so brilliant. Like, spoiler alert, when one of the reindeer dies in the first one, there's that little sparkle sound.
Yes. I remember that.
Yeah, it's just brilliant. I haven't heard Kringle Down 2 yet, so I can't wait to see what you've done there. Where did the idea come from? So the pop mine was a real thing where and when I grew up. Again, massive spoiler alerts, right? The what causes Kringle Down, just some imagery that has stuck with me from, you know, unfortunate incidents in life. But, you know, you try to take some of these grim things you see and make something even worse out of them. Actually, you know, you try to add a little levity and zaniness to it. And, you know, it's just the kind of stuff that I like. But, you know, a lot of people, a lot of times will ask an author and myself, you know, how did you come up with this? Where did it come from? You know, honestly, I think most writers will say this, you know, the story is just inside us waiting to get out. I never write hyperviolence or bad words, you know, anything beyond PG-13 in any of my writing. And, you know, this one is just, you know, F-bomb left and right. And strangely enough, I'm at my parents right now, as you can see by the homage on the wall. None of them blinked. None of them cared a bit that, you know, this was about as R-rated as it gets. And that was a surprise to me. My kids, you know, have never seen me talk or write like that. So it was really different for me. And it always just, it's just in there and it has to come out. And then I was just so lucky to meet you guys and have the audio version too, which is just so cool.
Yeah, it's been an honor to work on this series. And so Kringle Down 2. So you came up with that. It's like Kringle Down 3. Is it just sitting in a drawer waiting for next year? Is that what it is?
I actually wrote the first scene because I couldn't not.
Right.
I don't want to spoil Kringle Down 2 because you haven't released the audio version yet. But one of the protagonists from the first one, he grew on me. I really liked the guy. I thought he was smart and clever and cool. And I wanted to see where he'd go from there. And I thought, well, you know, after what happened, could he use that proactively to handle some of the loose ends? And it's, you know, it's a little bit of a stretch, but the whole story is a bit of a stretch. So.
Of course. Yeah. Yeah, so that's absolutely. Where that came from. Well, now you shouldn't have told me that Kringle Down 3 is happening, because like now I'm just like,
that's all he's looking forward to.
Now I'm like stretching my brain, trying to figure out what you might've done with it. So, Harlan, took care of the sound effects on Kringle Down 2 as well. Kringle Down 2 is this close to being finished. Harlan has finished all of his sound effects work. And if you guys didn't know, and if you haven't picked up Seance yet on our platform, then you don't know that Harlan has been playing with 3D sound, or what they call binaural.
Seance is spooky, man. You need to get
He did such a fantastic job incorporating it into Kringle Down 2. Now, this particular scene that we're going to listen to, I don't think you're going to hear so much of the 3D sound working, because there's a lot of motion. And like when there's a lot of motion, the 3D sound kind of goes out the window. Like even if you're using it, it becomes so confusing that you don't really get that sense of space that you usually do. But I wanted to play this scene, because Harlan put it together and sent me an MP3 of it saying, I know we're not using this song in the final version, but we should be. And so I listened to it and I said, yes, you're absolutely correct. We should be. I contacted Warner Chappell, the music company who owns the licenses to it. And I said, hey guys, we're putting together this little humble audio drama. It's got a pretty tiny budget, but we were hoping we could get a license to use this song for it. And you know, after going back and forth a few times, the second email I sent them the application that showed what our budget was. And then after all that, they said, okay, well, if you give us basically 2 times your budget, then you can use it. And then we want royalties too.
Oh, really?
So I was like, no, I mean, I want to, because as you will hear in this scene, it works so perfectly. And we're going to do it all, you know, not incognito. What's it called? Under the radar. You know, we're going to sneak it in here anyway. You guys are going to hear this scene with the original intended song.
Get headphones awesome. If you
and you alone.
And please, please, please listen on headphones, because it's
doing yourself a favor.
You would be. So, Ahmed, can you please play the little scene from Kringle Down 2?
Ernesto, Chin, Ruiz, and the two other toughs stood before the Cabeza family Christmas tree, picturesquely set beside the fireplace. It was chilly tonight for Cancun. Not really cold enough for a fire, but Ernesto wanted the ambiance. Harkins held out his hands to Ernesto.
The bug is in a present. Wrapped in red. I think. Silver bow? Wait. Maybe white? I only saw it for a minute. Take the cuffs off and I'll find it. Then you give it to me quick, okay? No more beating. Just one quick shot to the head.
Ernesto seemed unconvinced, but didn't want to look weak in front of the men. He nodded at Chin, who unlocked Harkin's cuffs. Max turned slowly and got on his knees.
I suspected my boss all along, you know. Just little things here and there that didn't make sense. Internal affairs was all up in the DEA's ass. But with ATF, it was all about Waco. They weren't looking for a cartel connection. That was smart, Ernesto. Zig when they think you're zagging and all.
Hurry up.
I know you'd come after me eventually. Dave and I really did a number on your crew. Or at least you thought we did. When Priestley gave me a mostly free trip down here to your family stomping ground, I knew what was up. So I decided to come after you before you got me. In my own way. Maybe a way no one else in the world could.
No one cares, gringo. Find the package now. If you're lying, I'll make it worse for you.
Max saw ash waft down the chimney. It was happening. He picked up a package and marveled at the wrapping. It was a professional job, gold foil ribbon and all.
Christmas. Never thought I'd die on Christmas.
Now, a much larger chunk of soot tumbled down into the fire from above. Then there was a sound, like leather scraping on brick from somewhere inside. The cartel men looked at each other nervously, then back to the fireplace. Ernesto signaled for Chin to check out the noise. Chin passed it on to Ruiz. Ruiz swallowed nervously and pulled a Glock from inside his jacket. He leaned into the fireplace cautiously and looked up.
Grew up in the suburbs. Just an average kid. Loved science, history. Never believed in Bigfoot, the Loch Ness Monster, aliens. Santa. Not even when I was little. No cookies, no cold milk. I knew better.
Thick black smoke began to waft from the fireplace, as if something were blocking the flue. A moment later it poured out in thick, dark clouds. Ruiz staggered back, coughing. All the cartel killers drew their weapons and covered their faces.
Why waste good cookies and milk? Mom and I just ate them ourselves.
Something heavy slid down the fireplace, stopping just before the opening.
But after the red onion, everything changed. When Priestley sent me down here, I asked for a Christmas present, Ernesto. Straight from Santa himself. It was a huge gamble. But I knew if you wanted me dead, it was only a matter of time anyway.
Something heavy landed in the fireplace, scattering fire and sparks and hidden by the thick black smoke.
Now? Oh, now I believe. I believe. In Santa Claus.
Come Santa Claus, come Santa Claus.
A large, jolly figure, clad in red, burst out from the smoke, a bag full of presents over one shoulder and a whip in the other. The leather lash snaked out and struck one of the thugs in the eye. White, egg-like fluid ran down his cheek as he screamed and ran headlong from the room. Then the figure from the fireplace slung his huge bag wide. The cartel men ducked under a barrage of presents. The killers opened fire at once, but shot wild and somehow missed the fat man. Ernesto dove into the corner, trying to hide behind the towering Christmas tree. His carelessness knocked it over. Its dry boughs landed in the fireplace and immediately burst into flame. Max rolled out of the way of the tree and came up with a Beretta taken from the same chauffeur who'd so generously given him the suit earlier. Two slugs hit one of Cabeza's men, and he sank slow and steady like the New Year's ball. Ernesto hadn't risen to lead the cartel by being unprepared. He came out of the corner with an M16 that had been hidden behind the tree. The drug lord sprayed the room with full-auto fire. The figure in red stumbled backward into the blazing tree. His suit seemed to repel the flame, but his belly shook like a bowl full of jelly from the half-dozen copper slugs that had pierced it. Santa, there could be no mistaking him, fell onto the tree, his red and white suit beginning to smolder. Max crawled over to the wounded man and looked him in the eye.
Dave, you still in there?
Santa gave Max a sly wink, roared with laughter, and stood. He hurled a flaming present at Ernesto and charged. Jolly old Saint Nick left a trail of thick black smoke behind him as he pulled his way forward. But the thug named Ruiz leapt out of the chaos like a flying luchador, pushing his boss out of harm's way and taking Santa to the floor. The two rolled into the flaming tree, then back out, dragging tangles of burning boxes and bows with them. Ernesto gawked at the unbelievable sight, then ducked as full auto fire burst out from behind him. It was Imelda, standing on the staircase, overlooking the study. Pablo and Isabella stood beside her, holding onto her sheer nightgown.
Mama, you killed Santa Claus!
Yelled Pablo. Max looked down. Ruiz was hit, but still alive. Santa was dead, though. Very dead. He stared blankly at the ceiling, with half his face shot off. Max looked up at Ernesto, then over to Imelda.
Oh, no. Oh, no. You have no idea what you've done.
That is fucking great.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah. So, very, very sad that we couldn't put the song on the final product. But I'm sure that Ahmed will come up with something this close to being as good. I'm sure. and like way better than spending that much money on it. Yeah, but hey,
perfect.
Nice exclusive Harlan listen Guthrie to everyone again. Here.
Holy mm-hmm. shit, man. Did a great job. Shane, so, this is such fun stuff to work on. What were you going to say?
Thank you. This is what you were talking about with the spatial technology, right? Because,
yes.
Man, those voices, I was looking left and right because yeah. that's where it sounded like they were that coming from.
And like the gunshots were.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh
yeah,
my gosh.
Yeah. Hey, this is the direction we're going. We're moving as much stuff this way as we can. You know, it's an extra bit of work to get it to work. You know, it's not like you just put something in there and then all of a sudden everything's right. 3D, right? You got to like kind of track the sounds and make sure that, you know, automate it to where it's, you know, we know where the sounds are going. But this is the future of our group now. You guys might recognize Shane's name also from Pinnacle Entertainment. Shane owns Pinnacle Entertainment, the tabletop RPG company. He's been doing fantastic. How many Kickstarters were successful this year for you?
This year? Well, all the ones we launch are always successful. We make sure they are. This year. So I think we did like 3 Kickstarters, but we also do them on our own site now, which we call Game Changer. And we did one with our partners in France called Game on Tabletop. We did 2 there. So we did Flash Gordon and East Texas University Study Abroad. We did a new setting by a guy named Tim Early called Holler, which is just brilliant. We did a Deadlands expansion. We did a lot this year. It was a big year.
And Pathfinder, right?
Oh, and Pathfinder, right. Savage Pathfinder. Yeah, huge.
Absolutely. So wait, can you tell us more about your... You're saying you basically made a new Kickstarter type of site? Or?
We did. So we love Kickstarter. We will continue to do stuff on there as far as I know. Although, I don't know if you've seen this. They announced that they're going to change to a blockchain funding model, which is, I don't know if that's good for all of us or not.
It's a lot of people.
Yeah. And, you know, I guess there's a, you know, environmental concern with blockchain stuff. They say they're offsetting it, but it's offsetting. It's not eliminating. So I don't know. But, you know, the problems with Kickstarter are you can only have 3 going at once, which, you know, is a good rule, I think, in general. But a company like ours that has a lot of settings to support, you know, sometimes we might have more than that just haven't arrived from overseas yet, because we do have to print when we do boxes and dice and, you know, plastic stuff, you know, all that has to be done overseas. It just has to. Sometimes those will overlap more and we have no control over that. We don't really mind the fee. I think the Kickstarter fee is fair for the marketing eyes that you get. The other trouble you get, and we haven't run afoul of this, but I've seen it happen with friends and other Kickstarter projects I've taken part in, where you know, somebody just hates the designers or some part of the project, they can really go on there and just ruin it for people. Yeah.
That suck.
They can. And I think we all want legitimate criticism to be you know, put forward. But, you know, somebody's just got a hate on for you and they just want to ruin it. They can do so. And they can just spam the comments and stuff. And there's nothing you can do about it as the project manager. You can report it, but unless they've said something, you know, racist or super offensive, you know, the Kickstarter probably won't do anything about it. Having a little more control over all of that is a big deal for us. But most importantly, may be of interest to some, so I'll make it quick. Shipping is a real problem, right? It's super expensive. It's slow these days, especially international shipping. So one of the ways that we amortize that is when you do our Game Changer funding, our entire store is integrated on the back end. So you pledge for Holler, for example, right? And then when it's time to ship, you say, well, I want these 30 other things that Pinnacle has made that I didn't buy the last 2 years or whatever. And it all goes into one package. Your shipping maxes out at like $100 if you're overseas or something. So you can really, you know, take advantage of that and make it much cheaper. And that's a huge deal for us, because when you use Kickstarter, you have to use a third party pledge manager, either pledge manager or backer kit or one of those guys. You have to set all that up You have to enter all the items manually, enter their pictures, all their descriptions, all that stuff. And while those guys are great to work with, it's a lot of time and effort, right? And when you have 1,000 and some products like we do, that gets pretty rough. So Game Changer, which our Savage Worlds line manager, Clint Black, came up with, is a huge deal for us. And we're setting it up so that we can sell it to others as well if they want to integrate it with WooCommerce, which is the most popular online sales platform. So not as exciting as talking about killer elves, but...
Right. Well, I mean, I you kind of got my wheels spinning here. This is a thing that you can, it's like a module thing that you can attach to your own store. It's not its own website.
Correct. It is a plugin that is, you can use with WooCommerce, and our web team could give you the specifics. And of course, you know, we're partners, so I'm happy to do so. I don't think it's ready to export yet. We're still working the kinks out, but it is a game changer. It's the term.
Wonderful. Yeah. 100%. We need to talk a little bit more about this after the show.
I mean, so the downside, right, is you have to bring your own market to it. Unlike Kickstarter, where you might get, you know, all the markets at least to look at your project. So, you know, there's pluses and minuses, but the control and just, you know, being able to do whatever you want with it, leave it open as long as you need to, et cetera, that's a big deal.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And so let's move on to Pinnacle. Okay. Because, okay, so all of your, you listed off a bunch of different things that that made it through Kickstarter this year. And for anyone who doesn't know much about Pinnacle, can you just give us a rundown of the Savage Worlds system?
So we make a core role-playing game system called Savage Worlds. The current edition is the Adventure edition. And then we make many settings that game system powers. Right, so Deadlands is our biggest and oldest. It's a horror western that you know, hopefully you'll see a whole lot more of in many different media soon. And we have we do licenses like we've done Flash Gordon, we did The Goon and Fear Agent with Dark Horse. We've done Rifts, the old Palladium RPG, that and those guys are just incredible to work with. Kevin Ciambieta is amazing. We did Savage Pathfinder from Paizo. Those guys are fantastic. And then we have just, you know, probably another dozen settings. If you click on that more settings, you'll see our Wall of Wonder is what we call it. Wow. All the cool stuff we make. Lankmar, The Last Parsec, Necessary Evil, which is what Gary did the voices for my Fallen story. Weird Wars.
You should listen to
So Weird Wars. We did Weird Wars. We did Necessary Evil. We did Last Parsec, and I think those were the three big ones. And then we did one thing from East Texas University.
Right.
So here's another question. Do you have more short stories coming?
We sure do. We're actually... so our fiction imprint is called Wendigo Tales. And we had planned... We did an anthology that we sold, I guess, about a year and a half ago or so. And you guys have done one story out of there. The ETU story by Aaron Rosenberg. We've decided not to do the anthologies anymore because it's just too hard for us to find slots to sell them among all of our game stuff that we have to support. You can see we have a lot of lines, right? So what we're going to do is we've opened it up to all the authors that we like, most of whom are published authors with their own brands and so forth, and they can submit their stories to us anytime they want. We'll give them an edit, get the art and the cover, put them together for Amazon print on demand. And every one of those will be available to Soundbooth so that Jeff, whenever you want them, they are yours to have at.
Hell yeah. Well, that's amazing. So right now, all of our Pinnacle Entertainment short stories are free. That's going to change next year. So if you guys want it right now, go pick them up and go check them out. Get them now. Gary ran the entirety of Weird Wars. He was our main producer for that one. Justin Thomas James ran The Last Parsec. I ran Necessary Evil. They're all really, really great collections
really
of
different.
Short stories. Really different. Really like every different. There's no two stories. It's like, okay, when are we gonna move on from
and
this?
Like,
no,
there's authors that overlap, but like the sheer difference of the stories is crazy. And like, they're all great. I'm not just saying that. They are all great. You need to get them when they're free.
Yeah, you
and they're
you
worth the money, but like you can get them for free.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I would listen to you guys read a phone book. You're all amazing. Every one of you.
Oh, that's coming.
2022.
That's coming.
The phone book.
Don't worry. We're doing the phone book. We got the rights.
How to make a dream, like the West Coast area.
Coming in 2022.
Well, Shane, thank you so much for coming and hanging out with us. Is there anything else that you wanted to say before we move on and start doing a ridiculous Batman script?
This camera.
Oh my gosh, I'm so going to watch that. No, just thanks as always for being our partners, for doing all this amazing stuff. And not just for, you know, reading it out of a book with a clever voice, but for all the extra work that you all put into it. I mean, it's noticed, it's appreciated, it is beloved.
Well, we very much appreciate all the content you feed us, and we appreciate you getting out there and making those RPGs for people to play. People are starving for them, and especially nowadays, I think RPGs are like kind of experiencing a renaissance right now. So
for sure.
you're at the forefront of it, and I'm so glad to know you.
You too, buddy.
All right, man.
Thanks, everybody.
Merry Christmas. And next Thursday, watch out for Kringle Down 2. That'll be coming
out. Just in time.
Indeed. All right, guys. You ready for some Batman?
Hell yeah.
Let's do it. Batman.
All right. Who?
Are we doing it as a screen scroll, or do we all have it? I don't think we have it.
Mm-mm. We're doing it as a
screen scroll.
Screen scroll is
screen
fine.
Scroll. Screen
Blackmail
scroll.
Scene. Okay, so this was requested by Mr. Sonovar here. He's in the chat. And whoa, that was a loud. Mm-hmm. Where'd that go?
I have no idea.
Dude, quit trying to make my balls tingle. All right.
So seductive.
It's inappropriate.
No,
all right.
I won't stop.
So. Did we get, how many suggestions did we get from the audience?
Oh shit, we have a
Let's
few.
Let's see, we got, what was that one?
This is a suggestion for Kleck.
Oh, Kleck. Kleck. Oh wait, I'm trying to remember his voice.
Kleck.
Kleck. Is it like this? Is this him?
Yeah. Okay. He's like more like nasally and kind of dropped down.
Like this? Oh, Kleck.
That right
this
there.
This wood right here.
Kleck. Yep.
Okay, let's see. Kleck and Amphorus. Okay, yeah, we can do Kleck and Amphorus. Okay, so Amphorus can
be so
fox.
Cute. Okay.
And I'll be Kleck can be Reese.
Okay.
All right, any Dungeon Lord fans? Here we go.
Okay.
What can I do for you, Mr. Reese?
You asked me to do the diligence on the LSI Holdings deal again. I found irregularities.
Their CEO is in political custody.
Well, I heard he was in police custody, but... not with their numbers, with yours. A whole division of Wayne Industries disappeared overnight. So I went down to the archives and started pulling old files. Let's see here. My kids love the Batman. I thought he was pretty cool too. Out there kicking some ass. Changes things when you know it's just a rich kid playing dress up. Your project. Don't tell me you didn't recognize your baby pancaking cop cars on the evening news. Now, you're getting sloppy. Applied Sciences was a small, dead department. Who'd notice? But now you've got the entire R&D department burning cash, claiming it's related to cell phones for the Army. What are you building him now? A rocket ship? I want $10 million a year for the rest of my life.
Let me get this straight. You think that your client, one of the wealthiest and most powerful men in the world, is secretly a vigilante who spends his nights beating criminals to a pulp with his bare hands? And now, your plan is to blackmail this person. Good luck!
Oh, man. The scene in the film.
That was perfect. We need to replace the cast. We need to reshoot this entire movie.
Christopher Nolan on the horn.
Yeah, mm-hmm. With Dungeon Lord characters.
Get this done.
Okay.
God, it feels so good to resurrect Amphoris. We need more content for Amphoris.
I know.
A podcast.
Oh, the Amphoris podcast.
I like to talk about cheese.
Okay, so how about Gary, you and DeProf?
Oh, yes.
What play the same scene. Let's get some more audience suggestions for this.
Oh boy,
I'm trying to scroll back up.
DeProf, I know that you're a little bit at a disadvantage here. If you want to, you can like
I can improvise.
Request your own voice for this.
But let's Nixon Snakey in the chat have some familiarity with some of the voices that I have done before.
Okay.
Via like Twitch streaming and stuff like that. So I think a few of those are on the table probably.
I'm just gonna whichever character I am, I'm going to be Korg from Thor Ragnarok. That's just what I'm gonna do.
Oh yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one. Okay, so
who would you like to be, Gary?
I don't mind.
Okay. How about you take Reese and I'll take Fox, and I'll do it as the nanny, and I'll explain the nanny after.
Okay. Right. Let's go.
All right. Yeah.
What can I do for you, Mr. Reese?
You asked me to do the diligence on the LSI Holdings deal again. I found some irregularities.
The CEO is in police custody.
Not with their numbers, my friend. With yours, our whole division of wine industries disappeared overnight, my brother. So I went down to the archives and started pulling some old files. My kids love Batman. I thought he was pretty cool too, out there kicking some ass. Changes things when you know it's just a little rich kid playing dress up. Your project, my friend. Don't tell me you didn't recognize your baby pancaking cop cars in the evening news. You're getting a little sloppy there, dribbling down your chin. Applied sciences was a small dead department. Who'd notice? But now, you've got the entire R&D department burning cash, claiming it's related to cell phones for the army. Hmm? What are you building them now? A rocket ship? I want 10 million a year for the rest of my life.
Let me get this straight. You think that your client, one of the wealthiest and most powerful men in the world, is secretly a vigilante who spends his nights beating up criminals to a pulp with his bare hands. And now your plan is to blackmail this person. Good luck.
I'd like to reconsider my plan of my course of action, please.
That would be a very good idea.
I'm going to go to the bathroom now.
Oh my god, dude.
That's
your
a
impression
great
of
voice.
It's which
spot
one?
On. What's the voice you're doing? It's kick ass. Yeah.
So I run a little D&D game on my Twitch channel on Wednesday nights, and long story short, the group has stumbled upon and inherited this this little baby dragon that they've been raising. And The archdevil, who was responsible in part for the creation of this dragon, sent one of his agents to just kind of keep an eye on the group. And he's a tabaxi rogue, and tabaxi are like cat people.
Nice.
So I just could not get Antonio Banderas out of my head. That's just who that was.
I can see tabaxi having that accent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So,
Annie, can you say baby dragon one more time as Aya?
As Aya, okay. Baby dragon.
Perfect.
Yes.
Baby dragon.
First of all, Gary, your impression of that character is so spot on.
Oh, thank you.
I love it so much.
Perfection.
Good fucking work.
Imagine people in New Zealand are like, we don't sound like that.
And people were asking for the Dungeon Crawler Carl AI.
Yes.
Let's do one more. Annie, can you be Reese this time and play Aya?
Okay.
As Reese?
Just say baby dragon over and over again.
And yes, baby yes dragon. Fit baby dragon in there somewhere.
You touch my baby dragon, I kill you.
I don't want to develop a snort when I laugh.
What happened?
It's there now.
Page 59, I believe. Oh, yeah, here we go. What can I do for you, Mr. Reese?
You asked me to do the diligence on the LSI Holdings deal again. I found irregularities.
Their CEO is in police custody.
Not with their numbers. With yours. A whole division of Wayne Industries. I don't know this story. I don't know. I've never heard of it. I'm sorry. A whole division of Wayne Industries disappeared overnight. So, I went down to the archives and I started pulling old files. Ah, my kids, they love Batman. I thought he was pretty cool too. Out there, kicking some ass. Changing things when you know it's just a rich kid playing dress up. Your project. Don't tell me you didn't recognize your baby pancaking cop cars in the evening news. No, you're getting sloppy. Applied Sciences was a small, dead department. Who'd notice? But now, you've got the entire R&D department burning cash, claiming it's related to the cell phones for the army. What are you building him now? A rocket ship? I want $10 million a year for the rest of my life!
Let me get this straight. You think that your client, one of the wealthiest and most powerful men in the world, is secretly a vigilante who spends his nights beating criminals to a pulp with his bare hands? And now your plan is to blackmail this person? Good luck!
Nice.
I know. Solid. Batman. I was just making funny. I was making fun of myself.
It worked.
Yeah, it was beautiful. Thank you. Annie doesn't. Annie.
I don't.
Annie,
I know Batman. I just can't Batman. Read.
She just. She just didn't know that Batman has a baby dragon.
I actually didn't know that Batman was the Wayne guy. But now I get it.
Massive spoiler. Shouldn't have said that online.
Yeah. You just.
I didn't know that Batman was Bruce Wayne.
Bruce Wayne's Batman. Oh my god.
Is Bruce Wayne the guy with glasses?
Christmas
who reports
will never be the same.
Planet News.
That's him.
That's him. All right.
Planet News.
All right. Well, okay.
The comic book writer's just like, Planet News. I don't know.
So, Sonavar, thank you for the request. We got some good laughs out of that one. How about we have Gary? We have games, and there's no changing this formula. Gary plus games equals
Gary's games.
Gary's games.
Yeah, so this is one we've played before a few times, and it always seems to we always enjoy it anyway. So
yeah. You might not like it, but we do. It's the commercials.
Yeah, we don't
so
care
have,
what you guys think. Honestly.
I have in my palm D20s.
Yes.
I roll three of them, and I have a little graph in front of me that I don't think Amit has a version of it, but this is slightly different because I've changed one or two things on it. Basically, I'll roll three D20s, and whatever numbers we get will correspond to a thing we have to sell, a feature about the thing that we sell, and in the style of. So, for example, I'll go first. I have three D20s. Ah! Roll one. Hey. I got a 13, which will correlate to a Tesla toilet. Tesla toilet that is totally trending right now. And then in the style of, oh no, a person with too much cheese in their mouth.
All right.
Okay. So, Tesla toilet. I'm going to get cheese in my mouth. So, actually, I'm just going to eat these like I did last time. So, like, otherwise, oh, I would like to tell you about something that's like totally trending right now. On all of the social medias, on Twitters, and TikToks, and you know, you can see images of it on the YouTubes, and it's the Tesla toilet. Elon
is tired of the cars. He don't like them anymore. So what he's gonna do is he's gonna make a toilet with electricity somehow. But he's gonna do, I don't know what he's gonna do, but Tesla bring in a toilet and you flush it, right? You flush, not normally, okay? You have to, like, you gotta look at the toilet and you gotta tell it a joke. And when you tell the toilet a joke, if it's a funny joke, it'll flush the toilet for you and your poops will go into the plumbings and that's it. So, I mean, go look at the Googles and the Twitters and it's all there. The Tesla toilet. And that's
perfect.
Funny. I was really, really nervous, Nyx, too, about the choking. But it was, you know, it's all part of the entertainment. You gotta have some danger in the
mix.
Yeah,
you really do. Really do. Gary was first. Lord. He took the danger first.
He did.
Very noble of him.
We're gonna
much
have
like
to one up him a little bit every time.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Have to eat different things.
So, I guess I can go get a belt and hang it from. it's not really a place to hang it right now, but you know I can get it.
I'm just gonna
figure some out.
Yeah.
Who would like to go next?
We me?
Go. I'll go.
Who was first?
Jeff, I heard you first.
Okay.
So I've got a 12, a cucumber-only diet.
Okay.
A 19, which is brought to you by the number 5. An 11. You hate this product. It's a cucumber-only diet that is brought to you by the number 5, and you absolutely despise this. When you're ready.
Hi, everybody. You ready for another fucking fad for your diet? Yeah. So, anyway, look, I know that all these other diets, they let you eat, you know, things that taste good, but this one. You're gonna lose some weight. It's gonna work at least, right? 5 cucumbers a day, for $5 a day, you can look fit and thin as a. I can't believe they're gonna make me say this. You'll be fit as a cucumber. if you go on this diet. So please give us a call. Yes, we're still taking orders by phone. 555 CUCU. Just
QQ.
I need to fire my agent, everyone. look, I know you want a new diet and look, okay, as far as diets go, yes, this will work. Just do it. Please, if you don't buy stuff from me, I'm going to get fired and I'll have to find some other shitty job. Okay? So, just please buy our cucumbers. There's at least 5 left.
There's at least 5. Is that just like thousands in there? Just like, right. Fuck, I don't check.
There's
inventory.
At least 5.
Okay, so 5. So have we been? We haven't been keeping score. So one second.
I'm gonna give myself five points, but I think you
really?
Got a solid 40.
I got 40.
I think 40 points.
Dude,
QQ 1-800 QQ. That's great.
Gary, dude,
you can be fit as a cucumber.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say at least 10 points for you. Dude.
I'll take 10 points.
Say 10 points for Gary. 8.5 for Jeff.
8.5 for me. Hold on. But Gary was saying 40.
100.
So
Gary says 40 for Jeff.
I said 40 for Jeff.
You say 8.5. Can someone do some quick math right now? The average of 40 and 8.5.
36 and a half?
That's like 24.25.
Actually, did math in your head. That's
I did.
That's
24.25. That's correct. Yes. So I have 24.
8.25
points.
Hi.
All right. So who's next?
Who would like to go next?
I'll go.
Okay. I have a 4, a popular children's book, 18, in the style of which is dishwasher and microwave safe, and four again, in the style of a very sad person trying to sound happy through their tears of pure, unfiltered, but filtered sadness. So that is a popular children's book, which is dishwasher and microwave safe, and you're really sad, but you're trying to hide it.
Oh man, she did one of these really sad hide it before, didn't she? She's good at this. She's going to get like a lot of points.
I've got lots of practice.
Lots of points.
didn't mean to make you happy. I'm sorry.
How dare you, Jeff?
Hi, kids. My name is Miss Miriam, and I've written a book. It's a very special book. It's dear to my heart. It's a book about my life and my childhood, and it's called The Girl Who Didn't Have Any Friends But Grew Up to Be a Very Successful Appliance Saleswoman Anyway. Something that's really, really special and unique about this book that isn't like other books is that it can get as wet as an ocean full of tears. And the ink doesn't run. It's also they can get as dirty as a bad little girl. Who was so bad that she got locked out of the house all night long and had to find food in the dumpster. And you can just toss it into the washing machine. And the ink doesn't run. Call 555-CU-CU in hell. And for four easy payments.
All right. I'm gonna say 60 points on that one.
At least 60.
At least.
63. Got
63.
It.
The callback to 1-800-QQ.
Points. All right. Mr. DePro. All right. Your turn. You have to beat 63 points, man.
Okay.
That's harsh. I'll do my best. That's harsh.
Do my damnedest.
God damn it, Annie. Why did you always setting the bar so high?
I know. So spike.
Stop giving me the sad characters.
I will spike knee pads. If it comes up again, I'll try to get rid of it. And a 1, that will set you on fire. And then 14, in the style of someone trying not to frighten a wild animal while also trying to get close to it. So I suppose like those Steve Irwin-y types. And go.
So
unless sorry.
Spike knee pads that will set you on fire. In the style of someone trying to get close to an animal without
a timid animal.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever wanted to knee someone and make sure that they bleed a lot? I know that I have. It's okay. It's okay. You don't have to go anywhere. It's not that strange. Have you also ever wanted to burn to death? Because we can do both of those things at the same time. The knee flame 9000s, they attach to your legs, right over your kneecaps. They are spiked, and they will set you on fire. You will eventually die if you wear them, but not before you achieve whatever revenge it is that you're trying to get by kneeing someone with spikes. Because why else would you get spiked knee pads? And no one will ever know. Because you'll burn to death, and there'll be no evidence after. No blood will stick to you. Nothing like that. We'll, as a matter of fact, pay you. All you have to do is pay shipping. We'll pay you $20. Shipping is $36.95. Call 999-UCUC.
Nice.
All right.
Thank you.
That was
Thank
good.
You.
That was good. I don't know, man. Okay. I don't know if you reached 60 on this one.
I don't know if I reached 60 either, but I mean, and he's got that like happy sad down
pat. Okay. I'm gonna vote 45.
Any, the product was solid.
The product was solid.
Product is, I want spiked knee pads.
I mean, who doesn't?
For
right?
sure.
For all your crotchular vengeance needs.
There we go.
Crotchular.
Do we have time for another round, or are we gonna?
I have time for another round.
Oh, let's do it. Let's
roll do it.
One more.
Okay. So wait. So what do we settle on? 45? Is that?
I give it a 50.
You give it a 50?
I don't understand the point scoring system at all.
I don't
either. But I do enjoy it.
Jeff, you figure it out.
All right. Well, you say 50. I say 45. That's 47.5.
Because Jeff, you always speak about the point system with like such a sense of confidence and authority that I'm like, Jeff knows the algorithm.
He's clearly he's got it.
All right, Gary, okay. You're really behind. 10
I'm
points.
Way behind.
10 points. That's it. I mean, okay. Thanks for jumping on the sword and going first. All. But I guess this is what you get.
I got a 7 and an 8 and a 10. So that's a refrigerator, which is Annie's favorite. And a 10, and I worship the product like it's a deity.
Well, because
a fridge
favorite,
that
obviously.
Annie loves. Oh my god! Do this, and I worship. Okay. Blessed is the box that is cold. It holds your food. It holds your drinks. You can open it and stand in its cooling warmth. And I'm going to tell you who likes to do this. My friend, Ms. Annie Ellicott. She has sponsored this refrigerator right here, my friends. She has written her name atop its door. And when you open it, we have recorded her singing to you about the fridge. And she has listed out a number of items, and we have pre-recorded. For example, if you pick out a can of your favorite beer, it'll say, here's your beer, fuckhead. I apologize, I interrupted Miss Annie Ellicott. This is her favorite fridge. She has signed it. And let me tell you, it will bring you to salvation. You will feed yourself. You will clothe yourself from this fridge. You ever know when you ever have a cold day, a hot day? I'm up to apologize for misspeaking there. A hot day, you are sweating. You've got what the crude people like to call the swamp ass. I'll tell you what you got to do. Take your jockstrap, your underwear of choice, place it in the freezer section. And in 10 minutes, take that out. Put it upon your person. And you will be free, my friend. Free of the heat. Free of the salty ball section. This is your way to salvation. And a round of applause for Ms. Annie L. got the sponsor of this fridge. It is her favorite, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to be yours. Call 1-800-SALTY-SACK-RELIEF.
Dude, the opening line was gold.
That was really good.
This is cool. Going to be no less than 108 points, in my opinion. Anybody
108,
else?
108. I'm going to go 109. I'm going to go 108. I'll go 108 and a half.
It was a 105.
108 and a half. So 108, 108.5, 109. Looks like our average is 108.75. 118.75, Gary.
Nice.
Okay. Firmly in the lead. And
I don't know if that's exactly right. That's exactly correct average, Jeff.
Jeff knows the point system. He wouldn't lead us astray.
Okay. You probably got it right. I don't know.
So, Jeff, I have.
Sorry. I don't know who got buzzed. I don't know if that was me or Jeff, but it was rude.
Yeah. Yeah.
I agree. For Jeff. I have a 17, a 5, and an 18, and I'm going to give you a chance to re-roll one of these, Jeff, because you have done it before. So the 17 corresponds to a voice in your head that describes the world around you. The 5 corresponds to... The fuck? Okay. Is too fast. So the addition to this thing is it's too fast. And it was in the style of boxy. which you have done before. Okay. So you can choose to do it if you want. That's fine.
No, no, go ahead and reroll.
Go ahead. That's a pretty epic
I would
combo
like to
there.
Suggest that we give Jeff an instant 20, which is Boxy doing an impression of Carl from Dungeon Crawler Carl.
Oh!
So that would be the nat 20.
Whoa.
Actually, the last three of the style I've really only applied to Jeff, unless we want to do Jeff's characters, because it's Boxy, Carl, and then Boxy doing an impression of Carl, or vice versa.
So or I'm Carl say you got doing an impression of Boxy?
Yes. I'm going to say you got a 20, and you can pick Carl doing Boxy, or Boxy doing Carl.
Oh, man.
No pressure or anything. That sounds difficult.
Well, okay, here's the problem with Boxy
doing... Or I can reroll.
Here's the problem with Boxy doing an impression, is he's a mimic. He can just...
He would just do Carl.
Sound
he
exactly
would just do,
like...
He would just be Carl.
Yeah.
Then Carl has listened to the series of Boxy and Everyone Loves Our Chest, and he's like, oh, wow, that's my favorite character.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
That sounds like something that it would be a challenge. Let's see.
It's also a lot of pressure, so if you want to reroll, we can reroll. And you can know it's there for next time.
Mm. Okay, what is the product again? I've been so distracted by this.
Is a voice in your head that describes the world around you, which is too fast.
Oh my god, dude.
So there's a lot of difficulty in there, so I'll give you the full reroll if you want. Or I can reroll the product. If you want to keep the...
The product and the issue with it are perfect, and I would love to do this.
I'm going to reroll, right? And then you can pick the reroll, or you can pick the 20.
Okay.
The reroll is a 1. Oh, drunk uncle at a party.
Mm.
Ooh. Mm. That's difficult.
Okay. All right. That's not going to be as funny, I think, as Carl trying
to do an impression of Boxy.
To do a Boxy impression as he's trying to sell a voice in your head.
That's too fast.
That describes the world around you too fast. Oh boy, okay. Let me try this.
One of the more difficult ones we've had.
A little bit, okay. Everybody, all right. So real quick, I'm just gonna get into Carl. I'm just gonna, you know, it's been a while since I've done his voice, so I'm just gonna, you know, do a little stretch here. And then what would Carl think of Boxy's voice sounds like? It'd be something like this, I think.
Yeah. Hello.
Yeah. Yeah, I think this would be Carl's concept of Boxy. All right. Hello, everyone. Would you like something shiny to put in your head? What? Yeah, I know. I don't like these people either. I don't like... What? No. Okay, well, we'll just put a pin in that right now. Everyone, if you would like something to tell you about your world and about how to level up. Yeah. Wait. Okay, stop it. Stop. No, seriously, stop. Jeez, everybody, calm down. If you want to know more about your world, that I can't even read the script with Jesus. Oh. I know the price. I'll get to that. I just, could you? Sorry, everyone. Sorry, everyone. I know you want to know the details of this product. It, oh, Jesus Christ. Look, everybody, look, you just, there's so many things. You're all talking so fast. I wish the audience would shut up. Oh. Wait, you're not talking, are you? Someone get me out of here. Oh, I'm going to throw up. I'm going to throw up.
Oh. Oh, God.
All right, sorry, guys. I didn't know how else to do it. I feel like I copped out a little bit at the end.
Not at all. Good. That's probably the most difficult combos we've had.
All right.
I felt real empathy.
Go ahead.
I felt real empathy.
Don't worry about hurting my feelings. What are my points here?
Well, you see, you got right into the character.
A solid 19.
19. Okay. What? Anybody want to?
I'm gonna give
I'd
it
say
a
22.
I'm going to give it an 87 and a half.
Oh, wow. Wow.
87.529.
That is very generous. All right. So 87.529. That's going
to... That's how Carl would have done it.
Yeah, probably. Probably. All right. So this is going to average out to... it looks like 36.735.
Yeah. Huh.
All right. Well, all right. Oh, I'm sorry. That's 36.735 plus 24.25. That's, I'm sorry, buzzer. 785, 98.
Nobody's ever going to understand Jeff's system.
60.
Has anyone seen QI? It's like a British quiz show. They also have a point system and algorithm that just no one gets.
Nice.
That's
what we have here. Is that like part of the like, is that... on purpose, or is it
yeah.
like...
Yeah, at the end of the show, there's the presenter be like, you get this many points, you get this many points. Be like, how do you calculate the points? It's like, no one fucking knows.
That's hilarious.
Okay, so it looks like my score right now is 60.985.
Nice.
So I'm not even... I'm just a little over halfway to Gary's score. I have no chance.
Damn.
So I gave it my all, guys.
You did your best.
I think I have a good one for you. So I have two 11s and an 8. The 11 for the thing is a Nintendo 64 in great condition. The 11 for the weird edition is it's a big honkin' chunker. And the 8 is you are way too intense. So you're way too intense about a big honkin' chunkin' Nintendo 64 in great condition.
Yes.
Excellent.
The one we all wanted, I think.
Right. Hey, kids! Look who's back! Razzmatazz Jazz coming at you on Saturday morning with your newest, biggest, most expensive Christmas present you're going to ask your parents for. But don't worry, because they are going to lose their shit! What I have for you is a Nintendo 64, but not just any Nintendo 64! Not just any Nintendo 64! Do you remember that movie, Honey, I Blew Up the Baby? You guessed it. I got a hold of that thingamajigger. I stuck that Nintendo in there. I blew it up! I mean, when I say I blew it up. Well, I would like to put it, in front of the screen for you, but the screen's not big enough! You're just gonna have to use your imagination! Hold on. My arm's going numb. Oh, shit. No arm.
Oh, no.
Oh, no. Oh, God. 200.
Oh, shit.
That was like ear appropriate. That little like not just any Nintendo 64, and you stopped, fucking glared at everyone.
All right.
Oh man, I'm saying 200.
You're saying 200.
I'm saying 200.
I'm gonna agree with that.
200 as well. I said 83. So we're looking at
Chunky Tendo. I did not utilize the word chonky.
It was so big, though.
Yeah, I'm going to have to deduct 5 points for that. So,
fuck.
All right, you're still at 171. So, yeah, you're way ahead. You're way ahead. God damn it. Gary almost had this, but you just...
Not after that.
You just knocked him right out of the lead. So, good work.
Yeah. Ooh. Okay, I'm going to probably have to give you a reroll on this. So, it's a 17. Which we've already done, so which is the head, the voice in the head. So I'm gonna reroll that 17. 6 is an American fork, which was referring to American fork. And we're in the style of
America.
We've already done is totally trending right now. Sorry, I got a 3. God, am I another 3? This is why I should not be allowed to play D&D.
That 10. Character gave me indigestion.
An American fork. That you can't wipe your butt with this.
That's the.
And the style of was Boxy doing an impression of Carl, but we've already done it tonight because it was a 20. So I'm rolling that. Oh, I just got an 8. Way too intense. A 3. Have we done a 3? Too much cheese in her mouth. God damn it. A 7.
Just put them all together.
Okay, so. An American fork. You can't wipe your butt with this in your favorite accent.
In my favorite accent.
Your favorite accent.
Can't be your own.
Favorite accent you wish to perform. You can't be like, well, I like how I talk.
Okay.
You can also take this as a literal fork if you want.
I think I'm going to be doing that, probably. I got to think for a second.
You certainly do.
Have you ever wanted a fork made in America? Congratulations. I have one here for you. And I even have it for sale for $9.99. It does, however, come with a disclaimer. You cannot wipe your ass with this fork. There have been too many lawsuits. We put the warning on the box, do not insert it to orifices that are not the mouth. However, too many people did. They ignored the warnings, and they took us for almost everything. I am 32 years old, and this is how I sound. I had to sleep in a garage for a month, and someone left a truck running. So please, buy my American forks. $9.99. Do not insert into your rectal or crotchal regions. You can call 999-555-FORK to order now.
You're finishing strong on those last two.
Oh,
Jesus.
Damn. Yeah.
Thank you.
Strong. At least 60 points. I'm giving
yeah,
you.
Oh, man.
I'm going to go 60. 69. I'm going to go 69.
69. Nice. Okay, Gary.
69.83482.
69.83482. 69.83482.
The sweet smell of desperation in the garage.
Plus 69.
I smelled those
plus
fumes. And I smelled what I deserved.
Three. That will be 63.
I like it's an American fork and it's kind of a British fork. I'm selling an American fork.
Well, those are the people who would fucking sell an American fork.
Right. They're just like,
Piccadilly Square, like,
six,
you know, American
four,
fork.
3, 2, 5. Plus 47.
Math time with Soundbooth Theater Live.
Equals. Yeah, that's 40, 53, 113.75878. Yeah. All right. 113.75878 is the last.
We don't round on Soundbooth Theater Live.
Depro. So man, you definitely are ahead of me. You came in just under Gary. Gary, you're at second place, 118.75. And he won tonight.
Close. 100.
Yeah, runaway victory.
171 points.
I feel like this is the first time I've won one of these.
I think it is.
The Christmas miracle.
That was one of the all-time best ones we've seen, by far.
Aww, listen to this.
Yeah, it's wonderful. So Ahmed put this together. For Kringle Down 2. Yes, there are sweet moments in that one.
So pretty.
So, thank you, Ahmed, for playing us out here. This has been a wonderful Christmas time Soundbooth Theater Live. And thank you, Shane, Lacey Hensley, for coming and making this a special one. You were awesome in the interview. You are a fucking business mogul. So we're happy to know you, happy to be allies with Pinnacle Entertainment. Mm-hmm. Joe DeProfio, thank you for coming and doing some improv with us.
Oh, always glad to.
Doing your brilliant
35-year-old old man accent. Annie, thank you for making us laugh and cry tonight.
Mm-hmm. Got wheezy.
And Gary, thank you for your goddamn game.
Love your game.
Love all of your games.
Jeff,
you made this worth it.
Thank you for making all of this, you know, from the clay of the earth. You know, none of us, we would all still just be clay in the earth if you hadn't created us. So thank you.
Yeah, thank just you, Jeff, you know, get to
for
work.
Creating us.
Get to work. Shut up. To work. Keep